States Navy S-2014 ship selection. With all the excitement and suspense of the NFL draft, you took surface warfare officers in the Academy's class in 2014 to choose the first ships of their Navy careers. And now, your host, Navy Officer Brandy Wills.
Exciting night for us.
Absolutely, and you are actually presiding over the event.
Yeah.
So, can you tell me a little bit about what the surface fleet of the future looks like?
Sure, I think so. It's a projection of the future. Nobody can really tell for sure, but I will tell you that about 60% of the ships that exist right now will be still in existence about 20 years from now. But we'll be building some very new and different ships. We've already started with the USS Naval, which will be commissioned in about 2 years, which is a completely different hull form and combat system and manning system than we've ever done before. And our next class of ships will be very, very modular in how they deliver their capabilities. So it's a pretty exciting future for us.
Yes, sir. With three crews on each LCS, what do you think the prospects are for COs for making CO rather?
Well, total combat ship is our next class of ship, and we've just finished the deployment of the first one, the USS Freedom, to Singapore. And what's different about this ship is they're designed to stay forward for 18 months, so we have three crews with three captains for every two hulls, and one of them's always forward. So these ships are large ships, but they're minimally manned. So to answer your question directly, having 78 crews will increase the number of command opportunities for our surface warfare officers out in the future.
Which is fantastic, especially for upwards of, I believe, the 250 midshipmen we have becoming swells tonight, so that's incredible. At this year's SNA, we heard about a program that is called, well, it's similar to the Air's Top Gun. So we have a new swell Top Gun. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
People call it the SWO Top Gun because it's the easiest way to describe it, but it's an attempt by the Surface Warfare Community to develop a command whose primary duty is to develop tactics, train tactics, assess tactics, and make sure that they're commonly distributed and trained to across the U.S. fleet, much like Top Gun does for air warfare. The aviation community has been very successful, and I think we need to model that for the Surface Warfare Community, so we're going to do it starting this next summer.
So it's coming up soon.
It is.
Fantastic. And what advice, what's your best advice you have for these slow studying?
I think the best advice I'd give any either a new officer or a veteran officer that walks aboard a ship is that they walk on board with a certain amount of respect that's garnered upon them by the fact that they're a commissioned officer in the United States Navy, and they got to work hard to build upon that respect by increasing their professional knowledge and treating their peers and their subordinates and the folks that we've asked them to lead with respect and demanding the same of them. I think if you do that, a lot of good will follow.
Well, thank you so much, Admiral, for joining us.
Right.
We're going to take it out to Petty Officer Timberlake. Timberlake, are these midshipmen ready to get the show started?
Well, Petty Officer Wells, I know I'm ready to get the show started, but judging by the energy in Mayhan Auditorium tonight, I'm pretty sure these midshipmen have been waiting quite a long time for this. Tonight's the night. We've got 243 mids getting ready to pick their ships for their first surface warrior assignments. It's a big night. It's really important for a lot of people, and it's very exciting to see the future of the Navy. So pretty soon we're going to get started. As soon as the ceremony starts, we will see where these midshipmen are going with their futures.
Well, let's get this party started. Distinguished guests, Naval Academy staff, friends and family, classmates, and shipmates, members of the brigade, and most importantly,
surface weather officer selectees of the grade class of 1991 plus 23. Related not to public. I'm Ed Gaddis, Director of Professional Development, and welcome to Ship Selection Night 2014. We've got a great night ahead of us, and I know you're all looking forward to getting on with the program, so I'll get right to business. And then as our guest speaker, Vice Admiral Tom Copeland, Commander of Naval Surface Forces. Admiral Copeland's had a very distinguished career. At sea, his commands included USS Benfold, DDG-65, and Destroyer Squadron 28, where he deployed as Sea Combat Commander with George Washington Carrier Strike Group to the Arabian Gulf in support of operations Iraqi Unit during freedom. Ashore, he has served in a variety of key staff positions, including Director, Navy Senate Liaison in the Office of Legislative Affairs, Chief of Staff for Naval Surface Forces, Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations and Training for U.S. Pacific Fleet, Commander of Joint Task Force Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, and most recently, Chief of Legislative Affairs. He's here tonight to help us celebrate this unique Naval Academy event and to lead us in bearing witness to this important personal and professional milestone lives of our newest crop of future surface waterfront junior officers. So thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule. Ladies and gentlemen, Vice Admiral Copeland.
Admiral Miller, thanks for inviting me. I know that there's a lot of anxiety about getting started here, and I will keep my remarks down about 55 minutes. I've rehearsed it a number of times, and I promise it won't be any longer than that. Unless we get into sea storms, and we'll take questions afterwards, and eventually we'll get to this. No? You know what I mean? Okay. All right. Getting a wave off from my LSO down here. Thanks for a kind introduction. This is my second time I've been here. I didn't make it last year because of sequestration and travel restrictions. I shared the year before, which was the first time I'd been here. It was pretty interesting and very, very much different than my experience at the Officer Candidate School in 1982 when a senior chief barked at us to go and grab the name of a ship on a popsicle stick and hand it to the lion hood and get back to work. This is a much, much better way of doing this. I think it's pretty exciting because, you know, as we discussed at the table, and I think all the old sea dogs in here will be able to affirm if, as the night wears on, your first ship is going to be very, very special to you. You're going to remember it for the rest of your life, and I don't care whether it's a good experience or a bad experience. It's mostly going to be good memories, I'll tell you that. My best friends in the Navy, lifelong friends, are all from my first ship, USS Leftwich, and I'm the only one left still hanging around on active duty, but we get together, and it's a brotherhood that I think will never be broken. So I got to tell you, it makes it pretty exciting to go up there and see these ships up here, and you're going to remember them forever. You remember the bonds that you make. I decided very early on to be a surface warfare officer. It's kind of our family business. My grandfather was a SWO, my dad was a SWO, and I'm a SWO. And so it's always been very enticing to me to go to sea. And I'll tell you, there's nothing better to me. And I trade places with you right now, except for the pay difference. to go back to sea again and give up my shore down desk job that I have right now, you're going to be very, very lucky. Today, the United States Navy, the surface Navy in particular, is existential to the United States Navy. We have been since the very first day this republic was founded. There's a lot of navies out there in the world. There's a few of them that have aircraft carriers and a few of them that have submarines. But there's none of them that are out there that calls themselves a navy that don't have surface ships and will remain existential to the United States Navy, no matter what happens to the rest of the fleet or the rest of the budgets. And we do a very, very important job keeping the sea lines of communication open across the world, patrolling the ocean seas, and we're out there when we need to be there. And so it's a very, very important. It's very difficult to get trained up and be good at our profession. And you'll be faced with a lot of hard work in the next couple of years. And what's unique about surface warfare, I think for most of you sitting here, and a little less than probably 3 or 4 months after you graduate, you're going to be standing on the deck of a ship talking to a group of people that you're charged with leading, while the rest of your compatriots are probably TDYing and sitting and waiting to get flight school started or go to nuclear power school. And by the time they're even getting to the first ship, you'll probably have 1 or 2 deployments on your belt and a bunch of really, really good experiences in leadership. So it's really something to look forward to. I've enjoyed every single minute of it. I've been doing this for 32 years, and it's been fantastic, and I really do wish I could trade places with you. The responsibilities as ensigns and JGs, I think, will exceed anything that your peers in the civilian community that have gone to even the highest powered Ivy League schools and business schools will experience for a long, long time to come for them. You're going to be pressed immediately into the role of being leaders of men and women that you might have to, on a very short moment's notice on deployment, lead into battle or lead into a space that might have been damaged. So it's very, very unique, I think, for a group of people of your age and experience to get out there very, very quickly. There's a couple of, I looked up just very briefly, there's a couple of LCSs up there. A couple of people asked me about them. We have four ensigns on them. You'll have two other people on the bridge on watch with you, and one other person on the entire ship on watch with you. So if you weren't thinking about an LCS, you might want to think, because you're not giving orders, you're just driving a ship with a little joystick. It's kind of a cool ship. It's our newest one. The Freedom just completed its first 10-month deployment. The Coronado just sailed away this week, heading over. That's the fourth one, and we're starting doing four a year. So if you haven't thought about that in the past, I know there's a few of them up there, and I convinced I think somebody at my table to maybe think about it, but we'll see. I got this list here for me. It's pretty high up, so if anyone wants to know what this list is, let me know. So, finally, there's a lot of issues that we face. You can't open up a newspaper and talk about the budget pressures that we face in the United States Navy. But I think at the end of the day, the surface Navy is a very, very good bargain for the American taxpayer. We make up 73% of the commissioned ships in the United States Navy. We are the preponderance of the deployed forces around the world, and we consume a grand total of 11% of the United States Department of the Navy's budget, so we're a heck of a good deal. We provide a lot of combat punch. We provide a lot of options for the president and the command authorities out there. And I'll stop talking now because I know you guys want to get up there and start talking about this. This is it. Any questions? Yeah. Okay. Where are you?
Now we have the number one order of merit on SWO selectees, Midshipman Bryn Unlock. Chip in the box, like USS Simpson. Next to pick, it's in a Justin Chuck. Good job, Slice. So USS Joseph. Chosen. Next up, Midshipman Audrey Petro. Midshipman Petro selects USS Donald of Cook. Next pick. Midshipman Jillian Coughlin. Midshipman Coughlin selects USS Donald Cook out of Florida Speed. Next, Midshipman Michael Madrid. Midshipman Madrid selects USS Lesson, Enemy Coast Guard Japan. Up next, Midshipman Brian Fritz. Midshipman Fritz selects USS Donald Cook out of Florida Spain. Next to select, Midshipman Samuel Dodson. Midshipman Dodson selects the Sanford leader out of Naval, Bahrain. Next up.
All right, I'm here with Midshipman Bryn Unlock, who is the first to choose her ship. How are you feeling tonight?
Excited. A little overwhelmed.
I really excited. Okay, and what ship did you pick?
I picked the Samson, DDG 102 out of San Diego.
Okay, and what was your choice about? Why did you pick that one?
It was a hard process, a lot of great ports to choose from. I decided on San Diego because of my fiance is an EOD officer, and so we're trying to find the best way to coordinate our schedules. And I absolutely love California and just need the warm climate. And then I had an awesome experience on the Chongqing this past summer, which is a destroyer based out of Pearl Harbor, so I was set on a destroyer.
Okay. And how's your family feel about it? Are they excited?
They're excited. I know they're watching right now, so this is a big night for all of us.
Okay, well, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Take care.
Thank you.
Carol Fisher. Jimmy Fisher strikes us as Fitzgerald on the coast of Japan. Next up, midshipman Polly Gissin. Midshipman Gissin selects USS Essex out of San Diego. Next to pick, midshipman Lindsay Darling. Midshipman Darling selects USS Iwo Jima out of Newport, Florida. Up next, Midshipman Patrick McAllister. Midshipman McAllister selects USS William P. Lawrence out of San Diego, California. Next to select, Midshipman Gerald Brimmer. Midshipman River selects USS Michael Murphy out of Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Next up, Midshipman Caleb Trugowski. Midshipman Trugowski selects USS Jaffe out of Pearl Harbor. Up next, Midshipman Aaron Fortner. Midshipman Fortner selects USS Donald Cook out of Rota, Spain. Next to pick, Midshipman Brett Mason. Midshipman Mason selects USS Curtis Lober out of Yokosuka, Japan.
Especially in the surface warfare community, early on you're going to be given evolved the role of Freeport to you at a very young age. And you'll be expected to take care of them, to lead them, to make sure their families are taken care of. Those kind of challenges are what make the Navy. We call it a Navy family, don't we? And it's absolutely true. And so if we've done our jobs here, when they leave the Naval Academy, they will find that they've got a family on a ship, and it will be as important to them as the families that they had back home.
Speaking on that, what is it about the Naval Academy that prepares them for those challenges?
Now, we've got a pretty rigorous four-year program here, but I think morally, mentally, and physically, our students are immersed in this for 4 years, some for five, and in that process, they kind of come to know themselves. And I think anybody that you talk to, whether it's their parents or their friends, will say, you know, they went in, like all of us, were just kids, and you grow so much in the Naval Academy because it gives you the opportunity not just to learn how to succeed, but it gives you a chance to fail and to learn from your mistakes and to get back up, dust yourself off, and figure out how we're going to defend America for the future, because there are no points for second place where in the business that they're going to go into.
Very true. And this is something we asked Admiral Coleman as well. What advice do you have for these midshipmen tonight?
I think you take every day as a gift. And you should be, we are so proud of them, as I know everybody who's listening are so very proud of them. But you take every day as a gift with the expectation that the best is going to happen. And I'll tell you what, if you're going life that way, in our Navy today, there's every reason to expect that there's going to be a great sunrise and another great sunset.
There's nothing like the sunrise at sea.
Yes, and or a sunset. It doesn't matter. It's all good.
Okay, well, thank you so much for spending some time with us tonight. Now, let's go over to Petty Officer Timberlake. Thank you, Petty Officer Wells. Let's take a look at what Admiral Rowden, the Director of Surface Warfare, has to say about ship selection night.
We do see the trouble. That's what we do in surface warfare. And the men and women that are going to be graduating from the Naval Academy this year, they're going to be selecting their ships. They're going to be part of a huge, huge, they're going to be a huge, huge part of what it is we do for the men and women that walk down the streets every day that never even realize what it is we do. But we control the sea. And our Navy controls the sea, and surface warfare's contribution is front and center of the night.
Up now, Midshipman Joshua Hildebrand. Midshipman Hildebrand selects USS Naval Golf out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next to select Midshipman Audrey Bauer. Someone is going to be the first. Next to pick, Midshipman Alexander Vaughn. Midshipman Vaughn selects USS Roosevelt out of Midport, Florida. Up now, Midshipman Juliana Everest. Midshipman Everest selects USS Paul Hamilton out of Pearl Harbor, Hawaii.
I'm here with Rear Admiral Bumatata, who is Commander Naval Surface Force Atlantic. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Oh, you're very welcome, I'd say, Mark Wells.
And what advice do you have for these future surface warfare officers as they begin their journey into the fleet tonight?
Well, first of all, I want them to celebrate this moment, because they've worked so hard to get to this place, and then more importantly, they made a very tough decision on what community they wanted to serve, and choosing surface warfare is an awesome decision, and they're going to learn so much about leadership from the first day they step on board. So my advice to them would be to do the same type of rigor that they did to get them through the academy. Work hard, do the right thing, listen to your chief petty officer, and most importantly, I think in the Naval Academy, they built leaders and leaders lead teams, build a team in whatever division you're assigned to, and then just go out and have fun.
Very sound advice.
Well, thank you.
You've gone through this before, so what was your ship selection night like?
Well, our ship selection night was a little bit more subtle, actually. Tonight's more of a celebration. And I waited to the last second to come out here to get this interview because the atmosphere in Mahan Hall is just electrifying people. I know there are some folks that are not first class, probably second class youngsters. They're all up there in the rafters cheering their fellow midshipmen on. And then I think a lot of the midshipmen here have actually done a lot of homework. I can see that they go right to a location or right to a ship. And it wasn't like that for us. You know, we didn't have all the flag officers and senior schools that are here tonight. I think our community has really grown in that perspective, that there's a lot more of the awareness of how important tonight is for the future of the surface warfare. So it's not even close at all. It's similar to what I had. And it's all for the good, though.
Yes. Did you get the ship that you wanted?
Actually, I picked not the location. I picked Hawaii. And then, funny thing happened along the way to basic training. They said I was diverted to another ship in San Diego, but it was still great. And it was just so happened to be the same place that I met my wife. We've been married for 29 years, so you know what? I love that detail. It was perfect.
Seemed to work out very well.
It worked out fine.
What are some of the challenges? What are some of the opportunities that these folks are going to be seeing in their future?
I think the biggest challenge for them is to get their team, whatever division they have, to focus into a greater good, and not as an individual, but to get everyone to understand why they're doing something, and not just work, because work is work. But if you work for a purpose, I think that's one of the things that they have to pick up real quick, that nobody's going to turn around and tell them how to do it. But their CO is going to expect them to do it, and the CO is going to expect them to be the best division in that ship. So what I would think as a challenge would be is to make sure they articulate to their people that every one of them is special and that entire division is doing something extremely important to the mission of the ship. I think that's the biggest challenge. And as far as just what they will find out going on their ship, it's a little bit different than the yard. I think the yard is fairly truncated as to what they have to do, where they have to go, you know, being in a place at a certain time. When they go to the waterfront, they actually lay that out. They lay that out for the team, and they just essentially have to sync up with the rest of the crew, and that's going to be an interesting transformation, but they'll do fine. And the reason why they'll do fine is because they have what it takes to succeed, and I think it's up to our community to get them all excited, and it's up to them to learn as much about a surface warfare community, because essentially, they're going to have the watch here in the future. Guys like me and Admiral Coleman, we're going to retire sooner than later. And it's going to be these young ensigns that are going to be commanding ships one day that perhaps can do greater things other than just command, but stay in the Navy and do something worthwhile throughout their whole career. So there's a lot more things to look forward to than they actually worry about challenges.
Thank you so much for spending some time with us.
You're very welcome.
I would like to get back inside.
Back to the celebration.
As it sounds. A lot is going on in there, so why don't we go ahead and go back inside as well?
Thank you. Midshipman Williams, Builder, Select USS Mason, out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next up, Midshipman Emily Hughes. Midshipman Hughes, Select USS Steele, out of Yokosuka, Japan. Next to Beck, Midshipman Trenton Wayne. Midshipman Wayne selects USS Jonas McKay, Yokosuka, Japan. Next up, Midshipman.
I am here with Commander Tom Dickinson from USS Barry. Sir, how do you feel about being here tonight?
Tonight's a pretty exciting night. Last time I was here in 1995 when I picked my first ship, and you can see the excitement on the faces of the midshipmen here. Same things I felt. A lot of emotions running through you as you start your career.
Okay. And What are you looking forward to most about having these new officers on board your ship?
Well, I'm excited to greet them and to explain to them what my ship is about and what they have to look forward to. Right now, the service navy is busier than we've ever been. We just completed a 9-month deployment in the Mediterranean, and we're scheduled to move to Japan, so I'm excited to tell them what's in their future, which is very exciting in and of itself.
Okay. So, do you have any advice for these new SWOs?
My advice to SWOs is come motivated. Get ready to lead people. We're going to put you in charge right away. That's the beauty of the Surface Navy. You're a leader from day one. And stand by for an awesome experience filled with energy.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. Back to you, MC1.
Next up, Midshipman Logan Wilk. Midshipman Wilk, Spice, USS John Paul Jones, out of Pearl Harbor. Up now, Midshipman Jose Iglesias. Iglesias flags USS Farragut out of Mayport, Florida. Up now, Midshipman John Founds. Midshipman Founds flags USS Wayne E. Meyer out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman James Thomas. Midshipman Thomas selects USS Pittsburgh out of Mayport, Florida.
With me, I have Captain Welch, who is representing the surface worker community tonight, LCS.
Yes.
And what does this night mean to you, sir?
Well, it's an exciting time for surface warfare to realize that there's 243 midshipmen. This is the future, the next generation of leadership in our surface community. And to realize that they're taking, this represents their next step in their professional development. And in a matter of months, every single man and woman walking across that stage is going to be on board a ship leading the sailors of our great Navy. That's pretty exciting to think about. And it's also exciting to see older people like me come back. And so it's the past, it's us coming together in the present, and we can also see into the future where our community is going.
So what was this night like for you?
It was a little bit different. There weren't any microphones. There weren't any cameras. Nobody did those kind of interviews. The process itself was pretty similar. Once we selected for surface warfare, you kind of did it all in one night. So you went from one big line, and then you got on the surface warfare line. And then we went into one of the Vols Memorial Hall, and we had the same big board, and you walked up and picked your first ship, which was a pretty exciting moment in the life for a young SWO candidate.
What made you choose the SWO community?
I grew up in Peoria, Illinois, world's most average city in the middle of the country. And so as I began to think about and investigate joining the Navy, the first pictures that I saw and the first things I thought about were ships, destroyers. And so throughout my time here at the Naval Academy, I kept coming back to that. It's what I knew when I pictured the Navy as a young teen. And it's what I keep coming back to, and the opportunity to drive ships was always exciting to me, and the chance to lead people early on was something that really appealed to me.
What do these midshipmen have to look forward to as soon as they pretty much exit this building and report to their ship?
Well, they've been here learning leadership. They get the chance to apply what they've learned the moment they step on board their first ship. So they're almost immediately, within a week or so, they're standing in front of a division and work center, and they're leading sailors. And that's a big responsibility. They also get the chance to learn on board the most technologically advanced ships in the world. And so one of the other great benefits to being a SWO, and it starts on day one and it continues, in my case, for 27 years, is the chance to learn something new every day. And that's a great opportunity.
What advice do you have for them tonight?
I build on what I just said. Always have an insatiable sense of professional curiosity. every time you step aboard the ship, every time you get a chance to stand in front of sailors and learn something. Those sailors are great technicians and leaders in their own right. They can teach these young officers and help them develop and grow. And the other thing I would say is just remember this night and remember this place that they came from. They have taken an oath and they have accepted a commission. And from day one, they are officers of the United States Navy. That's a tremendous responsibility. It's a tremendous privilege and pleasure.
Thank you so much for spending some time with us tonight, sir.
Thank you very much.
Alright, we're going to go over to Petty Officer Timberlake now.
I'm here with Midshipman First Class Madrid and Wilk. First of all, what ships did you guys pick?
I just picked the USS Austin, destroyer out of Yokosuka, Japan.
I just picked the USS John Paul Jones, which is now being homeported in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii.
Alright, why'd you pick that ship?
I was able to spend last summer in Japan. I really fell in love with the country and are excited to go out where a lot of the action will be with the foreign deployed forces.
What about you?
Has the newest combat system, and I'm really excited to test it out and try new things.
Okay, and what are you guys looking forward to most about being SWOs and getting out there and leading?
I'm looking forward to having people in the lead, sailors, the enlisted sailors. I'm looking forward to traveling a lot, hopefully making a lot of port calls all over the Pacific.
I'm looking forward to making a difference in the lives of the people I'm leading, and also just in general, in their lives.
Okay, thank you so much, guys, for being with us, and we're going to go back inside.
Jimmy Charles selects Mrs. Hopper's Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Up now, Midshipman Benjamin Walters. Midshipman Walters selects you as his Millie instead of San Diego, California. Next to select Midshipman Madeline McFarland. Midshipman McFarland selects you as his shoe. Washington. Next to select, Midshipman Garland Christopher. Midshipman Christopher selects USS Spruance out of San Diego, California. Next to pick, Midshipman Alyssa Kim. Midshipman Kim selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. Currently selecting Midshipman Alexa Rizzo. Midshipman Rizzo selects USS Boxer out of San Diego. Next up, Midshipman Gabriella Scherer. Midshipman Scherer selects USS Gridley out of San Diego, California. Next to pick, Midshipman Gabriela Torres. Midshipman Torres selects USS Bainbridge out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next up, Midshipman Ryan Dallas. Midshipman Dallas selects USS Shiloh living in Costa Rica. Next to pick, Midshipman Neil McMillan. Midshipman McMillan picks USS Stockdale out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Kelsey Shavok. Midshipman Shavok selects USS Lady Gulf out of Norfolk, Virginia.
Next up, Midshipman Eric Fadden. Midshipman X, Swatch USS Dewey out of San Diego, California. Next to pick, Midshipman Alan Hahn. Midshipman Hahn selects USS Blue Ridge out of Yokosuka, Japan. Next to select, Midshipman Kelly Ma. Midshipman Ma selects USS Shiloh out of Yokosuka, Japan. Next up, Midshipman Alexandra Lynch. Midshipman Lynch selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Cheyenne Whitney. Midshipman Whitney selects USS Germantown out of Sasebo, Japan. Next to pick, Midshipman Ryan Rapata. Midshipman Rapata selects USS Kidd out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Nicholas Delanos. Midshipman Galatas selects USS Boxer out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Grace Dalton. Midshipman Dalton selects USS Carl Vinson out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Nicholas Dubin. Midshipman Dewey selects USS Kidd out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Marissa Leon. Midshipman Leon selects USS Simpson out of Mayport, Florida. Up next, Midshipman Weston Kennedy. Midshipman Kennedy selects USS San Diego out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Elizabeth Rubin. Midshipman Rubin selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. Up next, Midshipman Sean Murphy. Midshipman Murphy selects USS Mobile out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next to select, Midshipman Ivan Subialdi. Midshipman Subialdi selects USS Carter Hill out of Norfolk, Virginia. Up next, Midshipman Bryce Boyer. Midshipman Boyer selects USS Calvin's. San Diego, California. Was it Roller? Anyway. Next up, Midshipman Amanda Parsons. Midshipman Parsons selects USS Ingraham out of Everett, Washington. Up next, Midshipman Daphne White. Midshipman White selects USS Decatur out of San Diego, California.
in their ships. Could you please introduce yourselves? I'm Cheyenne Wingate, 17th Company, and I chose the USS Germantown in Sasebo, Japan.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Jill Dawson, 29th Company, and I chose the USS Tomoko County, Rhode Island.
Okay. What made you pick the Germantown?
I won't pick the Germantown because I was looking at Japan as a platform first and foremost. And being forward deployed, I really look forward to getting out on deployments fast and in and out instead of being on long deployments.
Okay. And what are you looking forward to most about being on an LST?
I think mostly getting that interaction with the Marines and doing all the humanitarian assistance.
Okay. And what was your selection?
I was torn. I picked Rhoda because I've always wanted to go abroad. I went on a four-deploy cruise this summer, and I loved it, so I thought this would be a great opportunity to continue that trend. What I like most about it was the second question.
What made you choose that platform?
I'm looking forward to a smaller community, a smaller first command, just get to know the ropes better and work my way up from there.
Okay. What are you most excited about going out to the fleet, getting to your first ships?
I think just the challenge of meeting new people and really having people that work hard for you and you work hard for them.
And what about you?
I think about the same thing. It's rather daunting when you're looking at it, especially coming straight from here. It's definitely going to be a total life change, and I think we're ready for it. And it will do well.
Okay. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're going to take it back to the auditorium to see the rest of the ship selection.
Midshipman Arvito selects USS New Orleans out of San Diego, California. But now, Midshipman Taylor Sinus. Midshipman Sinus selects USS Russell out of San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Matthew Wolford. Midshipman Wolford selects USS Mitchell out of Norfolk, Virginia. Next to select, Midshipman Patrick Taylor. Midshipman Taylor selects USS San Antonio out of Norfolk, Virginia. Up now, Midshipman Paul Winston. Midshipman Winston selects USS Rodney Davis out of Everett, Washington. Up now, Midshipman Barclay Walter. Midshipman Walter selects USS Radio LCS Crew 101. Up now, Midshipman Michaela Benalt. Selects USS Carl Vinson out of San Diego, California.
I'm here with Vice Admiral Michelle Howard. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, man.
Absolutely.
What do you think about tonight so far?
Oh, it's inspirational, the enthusiasm, and just the joy of watching these midshipmen pick their ships and pick their future.
Okay. And what was your ship selection like?
Well, for one thing, it was very different. Ships had just opened up to women while I was at Annapolis, so there were only 7 ships available for women. And then everybody else was either going to be supply corps or intelligence, so I got the 7th of 7 ship slots. So it was very exciting for me.
So was that the ship that you wanted?
I just wanted to get to sea, so compared to the opportunities the men had at the time, it was just elusive thing, it felt like. So it was wonderful to get that ship.
What do these SWOs need to do in order to succeed in the fleet?
Well, they have all the skill sets they need. They got them here. They're just going to have to practice leadership and management. They're going to be terrific.
And a lot of these midshipmen are going to Hawaii and Japan. So, what do they need to know about our rebalancing and our refocus to the Pacific when they get out there?
Whether they're engaged in Hawaii and Japan or in Rota, Spain, our ships are globally distributed and globally deployed. So it's making yourself a joint war fighting ready. Your home port is where your ship's based out of, and you got to be ready to go anywhere at a moment's notice. What advice would you have for them tonight? Have fun. It's a wonderful life. It's a wonderful career they've chosen. And they're going to be terrific leaders. They just need to have fun. Is there anything else you would like to add?
Nope.
Thank you so much for giving us some of your time, and I'll let you get back inside to go.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Midshipman Warner selects USS America, San Diego, California. Up now, Midshipman Brennan White. Midshipman Wyatt selects USS Bacon Island out of San Diego, California. Next up, Midshipman Matthew Van Hallinger. Midshipman Van Hallinger selects USS Kearsarge out of Norfolk, Virginia. Up next, Midshipman Jack Dubowski. USS Fort McHenry out of Bayport, Florida. Midshipman Brandon Carter. Midshipman Brandon Carter selects USS Big Ridge. Brian Roby, you're on deck. Midshipman Matthew Bernucci. USS, Midshipman Bernucci, go ahead. Midshipman Barry Chester. So Chester says USS Independence out of San Diego. Midshipman Maddox, USS Austin, out of your Cusco. Midshipman Matthew Jackson. USS Normandy, out of Norfolk, Virginia. Midshipman Connor Murphy. Midshipman Murphy selects USS Hopper out of Pearl Harbor. Midshipman Shannon Levin. Midshipman Levin selects USS Fort McHenry out of Midport, Florida. Midshipman Thomas Kraft. Midshipman Kraft, USS Green out of San Diego, California. Midshipman Benjamin Simpson. Midshipman Simpson, USS Preston out of San Diego. Midshipman Stephen O'Dell. Midshipman O'Dell, USS White City, out of Bayport, Florida. Good job. Midshipman Michael Nugent. Midshipman Nugent, USS Lake Erie, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Robert Yerkes, Medina.
Ship Jerk is with USS USS Brent Bold. Strong. Ship Elizabeth Miller. Ship Miller, USS Ashland, Sasko, Japan. Shipman Jeffrey Myers. Shipman Myers, U.S. Historic Washington, on your coast to Japan. Aircraft carrier. Shipman Jerry Frost. USS Freedom, San Diego. The ship is this figure off. The ship is figure off at USS Lesson on the coast of Japan.
Another successful year, another successful show, our second one. What did you think, Timberlake? Surface warriors with all the new technology, LCS, DDG-1000, the new ballistic missile defense stuff. Like, the future is very, very bright for the Navy and for these midshipmen. So, if you had to put LCS up against DDG-1000 in the Super Bowl, what would your pick be? Well, I'm never going to afford DDG-1000. So, I'm going to have to go with LCS. They're amazing. They're flexible. They do, like, everything, different mission packages. Like, LCS, it's pretty much the deal. And to the Trinity City Station, right? Well, they work really hard. What about the Super Bowl? What are you thinking wrong? Oh, I gotta go with my Seattle Seahawks. I was stationed in Bremerton. I did some time up there, so I feel like I'm really, truly a Seahawk at heart. We'll see tomorrow, Super Bowl. Well, please continue to watch the rest of the ceremony on Navy.mil. From all of us at the Defense Media Activity, thank you so much for watching, and continue watching from the Mayhem Auditorium. Have a good night.
So let's go, Sixers, to the Hampton Roads. I should have David Allison. This is poor ball, Pearl Harbor One. This should be Rachel Hunter. This should be all wrestlers. This is poor out of Norfolk, Virginia. This should be Hunter Gaskins. Should we guess the selection was just like Gary out of Harbor Way? Should we Karina Schmidt? USS Angelo, my poor Florida. Ship is Scott Snowden. This is Fort Worth, San Diego. Ship is David Norman. This is Fort Worth, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. Ship is Chelsea Smith. The ship is waiting through USS Roosevelt out of Mayport, Florida.
The ship is crystal clear.
This is like ship Lang. I ship in Austin, Reno. Or Eric Lies, either one. I ship in Reno, Slexi, this is Ashley. I ship in Nicholas Martinelli. So we go home.
Thanks,
bud. So Mark's Billy, who says Gettysburg, Mayport, Florida. But ship in Jonathan Wood. But ship in Wolf's Lake, who says Baton, Norfolk, Virginia. But ship in Catherine Moore. Ship in Warm Slicks, USS Grantley, Norfolk, Virginia. And ship in Trina Grabowski. Ship in Grabowski Slicks, USS Porcetina, Pearl Harbor. And ship in BHS Cabon. Ship in Cabon Slicks, USS Ashland, out of Fresno. It's ship in Roberto Garcia. It's ship in Garcia Slicks, who says Mike's Burrow, out of Mayport, Florida. It's ship in Michael Zintrow. Shipping to Josh is the USS Port Royal. A ship in Cassidy Simmons. A ship in Simmons 6 USS Osaka, close to Japan. A ship in Andrew Miller. A ship in Miller USS Chancellorsville. Pearl Harbor. A ship in Samir Shake. A ship in Shake Slicks, USS Mahan, out of Norfolk, Virginia. A ship in Spencer Wilson. Ship in Nicholas Jasmine. Ship in Jasmine Slicks, USS Lake City, out of Mayport, Florida. A ship in Graham Vickers. A ship in Vickers Slicks, USS Mobile Bay, out of San Diego, California. A ship in Joyce Kim. Ship in Ken Slicks, USS Jefferson, out of Sasebo, Japan. A ship in John Muti. A ship in Harry Slicks, USS Princeton, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. A ship in John Michael Gibb.